Claudia, who's talking today.
Well, I feel I almost have to apologize about keeping you inside at this hour, but and considering that it's been raining, I'm not coming out of the weather, but still, bear with me, I'll try to keep short. I want to speak today about the question of the fragmentary in architecture, and have been trying to develop my the topic of my PhD in order to relate to the summer school in Dubrovnik and this question about the possibility of a philosophy of architecture or architectural philosophy. And maybe as a spontaneous reaction to Professor Greiter's systematic from yesterday, I found that very interesting, the question of the four stages of thinking architecture. And so the topic of the fragmentary can also already be positioned inside these four stages. Interestingly enough, for me, it's on the verge between the second and the third. It developed in what you call the traditional phase of thinking of architecture, and it reaches its peak or its temporary peak on the verge, on the border to the third phase, to the phase of going inside what we call critical theory. The notion of the fragmentary occupies a central position in philosophical and artistic modern discourses. It marks the beginning of modern aesthetics and their detachment from the concept of the whole. The concept of the fragmentary had already been developed in the early Romantic as a progressive notion. By the end of the 19th century, the fragment had then advanced to a metaphor for a contemporary sense of loss inflicted by the development of new information technologies and their influence on one's perception and sense of reality. Authors like Georg Simmel, Siegfried Krakauer, or Walter Benjamin describe the expression of this new phenomena in the field of art as forms of the ephemeral or the transitory, and they are following closely Baudelaire's definition of modernity itself as le transitoire le fugitif. This talk tries to illustrate possible resonance fields of the notion of the fragmentary in the architectural production after the Second World War, while raising questions like, can architecture be a form of expression of the modern condition fragmentaire? Does the notion of fragment develop in architecture in a similar way it did in visual arts, philosophy, or literature? The term fragment is used today mostly in reference to the process of fragmentation, regardless of the place or epoch to which it may apply. And yet, there is a fundamental difference between the meaning of the fragment in the modern era and its earlier anticipations. The fragment, as we know it today, has its origin, as I said, in the 18th century, when it was situated as a symbolic meaning, then transformed into a problematic issue of what one would call independent or relatively autonomous entity. In one of the most celebrated and quoted statements defining the modern condition of thought and art, Friedrich Schlegel noted in his Archideum Fragments that, and I quote, "Whereas many works of the ancients have become fragments and are known only in the forms of ruins, many works of the moderns are fragments at the time of their origin." So for Schlegel, As for many writers since, the fragmentary nature was a contemporary importance precisely because it reflected and thereby expressed the sense of incompleteness, openness, ambiguity and potentiality, and that has been the core of the modern achievement and dilemma in the production of art until today. This development of the notion of a fragment is simultaneous with a dispute about the validity of the ancient aesthetic role model or ideal of the Greek tradition that took place at the end of the 17th century at the Academy of Arts in Paris, and this debate is known to all of us as Le Querelle de Ancien et de Moderne. Almost at the same time in the visual arts emerges the phenomena of the artificial ruin. I have to apologize about the undertitle in German. I missed it. I missed it to translate it. We find here an example in these two paintings by Hubert Robert, which were shown in the Louvre in 1767. There are two pictures of the Grand Galerie du Louvre, once as a whole room in itself and once as a ruin. This is what behind these two pictures it was the philosopher Diderot who developed the concept of the poetic of the ruins, la poétique de ruine, which was his definition for the mode of reflection inflicted by this situating an architectural or a spatial configuration in the ambiguity of time between its reality and its future. The question and relevant for us is how this relates to architecture, and now I would like to make a huge step in history in order to point to something that I would name at this moment a productive misunderstanding. I named this step the deceptive break of silence or the excesses of the fragmentary, but what I'm referring to is a special moment. It's the year 1988, as the exhibition at the MoMA bearing the title Deconstructivist Architecture in New York was opened by Mark Whitley and Philip Johnson, who announced that the field of deconstructivist architecture as a radical break from the past architectural forms. Just as Jacques Derrida's philosophy of the deconstruction had changed before the long-standing notions of truth, essence, and transparent communication, so too the deconstructivist architecture undermined in their description any notions of architectural order or home. These new forms, using displacement, distortion, disintegration, and rupture, obliterated the geometrical purity and unity of previous architecture. I would like to quote from the press release for the exhibition, in the words of Mark Whitley and Johnson, the description of this new phenomena. They describe the deconstructivist architecture as a reunion of architects who, I quote, recognize the imperfectibility of the modern world and seek to address the pleasures of unease. Obsessed with diagonals, arcs, and wrapped planes, they intentionally violate the cubes and the right angles of modernism. Their projects continue their experimentations with structure initiated by the Russian constructivists, but the goal of perfection of the 20s is subverted. The traditional virtues of harmony, unity, and clarity are displaced by disharmony, fracturing, and mystery. What raised immediate questions back then and still until today was the fact that the curator insistently claimed that the use of distortion and impure forms in architecture was something new. Their description implied that all previous forms of architecture were governed by one and only one paradigm, an abstract ideal that embodied some kind of mythical notion of classical order. By doing that, they ignored let different forms of architecture disappear, pointing at notions like mannerism, the Rococo or Piranesi Scaccelli, the Pittoresque, and so on. It was historians like Robin Middleton or Dalibor Veselý who, among others, have suggested that the history of fragmentation had begun long before that. Robin Middleton presented in a brilliant essay on Sir John Soane aspects of the fragmentary in Soane's rooms, which are built up by enclosing mirrors or planes of light or shifts or tangential views, which develop a new form of room, separating it from the concept of the closed whole. It was also Sir John Soane, together with the painter Joseph Gandy, that developed this well-known picture of the Bank of England as in a state of what you would say at the first glance ruin, but secondly as an order of predisposition of a construction site. I've already pointed today, as we had the discussion about the Tower of Babel, on the possibility of accepting the ruin as a pendant of the construction site, or as an equivalently object that relates to a non-directional time understanding. The British architect and historian Robin Evans argues in his book The Projective Cast that, and I quote, "A fragment is always part of something larger. Usually, it has been broken off. However, in order to make any sense of the material about to be considered, a modified definition is needed. For our purpose, and this is important also for this presentation, a fragment is something that looks as if it had been broken. In architecture, anything more than this, with a very few exceptions, is either an accident or a disaster. A fragment, real or imaginary, must have a past." So we see it throughout the ongoing architectural debate in the later 18th century or 19th century until the 20th century, the question of on the question of structure, function, and ornament or representation, the ruin has generally served as an avatar for the fragmentary. But my argument or my point of interest in this case is to speak about the fragmentary in architecture not as the ruin, but as a progressive notion like it has been developed at its very beginnings by literates like Friedrich Schlegel. Let's look at the time. I think I'm taking quite long, so I'll speed up. Okay, it is nevertheless, Robin Evans, who points on three phases on the development of the fragmentary during the 20th century. He identified a first period between 1910 and 1920, where he points at the influence of Cubist painting on architecture, and also on the difficulties about this issue. The second phase, in Evans' opinion, are the post-war years, when it appears that the fragmentary stays for a new form of bringing humanization back to modern architecture, And thirdly, for Evans, is the epoch of the postmodern, when he sees in the fragmentary the signal of the end of humanism and the end of modernity. Interestingly enough, is when starting to make this comparison, Evan points on the different acceptance of the avant-garde of the 20s in arts and in architecture. Because, and I'm quoting, he says, cubism, especially in the painting of Picasso or Braque between 1907 and 1912, were the source of fragmentation in modern art. And at the same time, modern architecture, on the other hand, it is said to the same time to be total architecture, monadic to a fold, totalitarian even. Such is the consensus, and Evans is very interested in showing that it is not a question of either nor, or of either fragmentary or totalitary, but that these two phases coincide. He points in these three phases to the moment of the first writings on the term of the fragmentary, even though it's not called fragmentary yet. It was it appeared in Siegfried Gideon's Space-Time and Architecture, where Gideon is pointing at some comparison between the Bauhaus wing designed by Walter Gropius and Picasso's La Plaisienne, and try to evoke the same moment of what he calls simultaneity in both these works. His argument is that through transparency, the Bauhaus wing manages to show, to work, to explain itself in the same simultaneous way as a cubist painting would try to relate to a body from different perspectives at the same moment. It is quite a constructive argumentation, but the interesting point about it is that Gideon himself offers later another explanation to the term of the fragmentary, and that is in the second edition of his book, where he relates to Alva Aalto, and he puts him and his work under the notion of irrationality. He states that history had advanced far enough at this stage so that the new stage of modernism can be announced. Gideon says that rationality had been achieved, so the necessity to restore a certain irrationality is now given. So architects like Alva Aalto are for him exponents of that. I skipped one folia, but I wanted to return to that. This question of the silent denial of the universal is kind of a general concept of what one defines as a philosophy of the other moderns. Also, yesterday we've been speaking about them. I'm not very sure about it, if he was the first one, but I found Colin St. John Wilson's writings, this term of the other or the moderate moderns, and he relates to on the one hand persons like Alva Aalto, Hans Schabun, Sigmund Leverenz, and so on, and calls them the silent voices of the modern, on the one hand, and on the other hand also the lost causes, more or less, or the not so obvious avant-garde. That's what I meant with that. What's interesting about Alba Aalto in this conception is the non-obvious form of the fragmentary that we have presented here. It is Robin Evans again who calls it, and I quote, a philosophy of emollience or softness. In describing the project of and the building for the Baker Dormitory at the MIT, he says that the building, and I quote, is not calm. The contrast between the jagged edge in the plan recalls a generation of cubist guitars, maybe. However, the north face of the MIT dormitory may also be understood in the context of emollience. Between the totality of an institution and the privacy of the individual, a full range of encounters and groupings, formal or casual, diversified or homogeneous, is possible. If buildings function as a perfect shell for people's lives, the diversified contours may be assumed to send for a diversified occupation, casual distribution for casual encounter, architectural monoliths for social monoliths, and so on. So what is here pointed at is the emollient or the soft aspect of the fragmentation. Something was broken up, but it's not primarily the volume or the shape of the building, but the totality of the institution behind that, or the perception of the institution. This aspect I find very important while argumenting that the question of the fragmentary is not about the question of fracture, or not only, or about the question of the ruin and so on. I brought a second case study with me. It is Hans Scharoun, which is an interesting personality because he developed his work during these whole three phases that Robin Evans announced. So he began at the beginning of the 1910s with, I think, his first project at the age of 17. Work during the war and after the war, and signaled through his development all these phases as a part of expressionist groups like the Les Amerquette or the Ring, through the influence of Hugo Herring on his work, and at the end through his most known design of Scharoun, the Berlin Philharmonic. This is not it. What is important is that the picture that I had before was a photo of the young Hans Scharoun just preparing, or at the time that he was called as a professor in Breslau. He's filling Easterbrook, and in his inaugural lecture for Breslau, he develops for the first time notions that point to aspects of the fragmentary without calling them as such. It is a quite confused definition of what he means. It seems to be an attempt to develop something like an artist theory, but he works with terms like the non-perspectivical, the multi-perception. He tries to find a definition for that, but it's not there yet, not in words. It is also important to know about Scharoun that working as a director of the Academy in Berlin, he was, of course, all the whole time in contact with the peak of the art development at that time. As Luca was pointing at this morning, it is exactly the time where the question of space and time as a congruent becomes important. There are different works of art who point to that, from Boccioli to Molinot. To all this connection, there is proof in Scharoun's correspondence that he was aware of that and that he was also working on these topics. But maybe what the most obvious relation to the question of the fourth dimension in the concept of consciousness is the influence of the philosopher Jean Gebser, a Swiss philosopher who develops in the 50s the concept of the perspectivical space. I will not go into detail. I'm more excited on your comments about this parallel. Maybe just to show a few hints of how architects like Hans Scharoux try to develop their language around this philosophy, around these notions, is by taking a look in his writings. I have exemplary some notes that Scharoux has prepared for two courses that he gave at the TU Berlin in, that's my timer. he gave at the TU Berlin, where he was speaking about the first course is called Theater in, Theater in Wandel, der Struktur Theater, in changing, I think, the structure. And what I find interesting is that he already borrows these notions of the perspectivical, but he's working with very imprecise definitions of that. You see some influence of Gebser, but you also see influence of Adorno at some points, because he often speaks about the Entfremdung and not the right term in English, but it would be I will stick with it, Entfremdung. Alienation, yes, thank you. And the second point that he makes in these courses is as in Gebser's concept of the perspectivical consciousness, is the question of the fourth dimension of the of time he points to the inclusion of time as the fourth dimension for what Gebser calls integral consciousness. If we think further, we can relate it, of course, to the question of the spatial turn, where through this fourth dimension, the position of the subject in space is getting more and more important. The space as a container is being liberated through concentrating on the space developed through through perception, through subjectivity. I marked the positions, of course, it's everything in German. So I will stay here and thank you for one hand the formal act that Alto makes with this jagged line, but also looking inside the space, the dispositions of individual and collective space and their relation to each other.
So there's like a hierarchization of
yes.
Secondary and collective relationship.
That's what they all want.
Other questions?
Yeah, thank you very much. It was very interesting. just a comment on a couple of things. You mentioned that in Cubism already the fragmentary is a topic in the early 20th century, and that architecture resists somehow still resists these discourses and holds on to a kind of architecture which is conceived as a whole. I think it's very important here that the concept of monumentality is probably blocking architecture to make the next step.
Yeah.
So if you look in the late 19th century, early 20th century, even still, the competition for the high-rise building in Friedrichstraße, there's only one competition which was spectacular, was Mies. All others dealt with monumentality in a classical sense, so in a traditional sense. It was big building mass, longevity, and stone. And probably this is something interesting, that this was then after World War I, somehow at a certain point this collapses, this idea of monumentality. The question would be, how much, what share has the war experience of these people? Is there a connection to the destructive power and the destruction of World War I in terms of the concept of the fragmentary? And that could be maybe interesting topic. As well as then, again, after 45 and the 1950s. And for me, this is interesting. Yeah. Anyway, it's a fantastic photo. That you showed that Darwin, the concept of time, he introduces a kind of concept of the fragmentary, which is not the traditional notion of the fragmentary. So you can consider that phenomenopole, as it is presented here, maybe a concept of an architectural concept of the fragmentary, which is not having just throwing something on the floor and then assembling fragments. I think this is not really architectural. In this sense, you could make an interesting point saying that the MoMA deconstructivist, this is a fallback behind Hans Scharoun, because they forgot, they never knew. They were not informed, because they had another agenda, especially Philip Johnson and Mark Wigley. They wanted somehow to promote Russian constructivism. So they were the new, they discovered Russian constructivism as something, if you read the text, it has nothing to do with Russian constructivism, that could be, if that could be a point, that could be an interesting point to show that Scharoun comes up introducing the concept of time through theater and here, of course, through musical performance, that it is exactly this time dimension which opens up some of the discourse for the very specific idiosyncratic concept of the fragmentary in architecture.
Yeah. The interesting part that I find about it is that there is a relation between this humanistic concept of time in relation to the fragmentary and the beginnings of the fragment, even though they are different. But Schlegel also refers to time as one of the first things that he uses in the definition of the fragment as a progressive form, and this loss of direction, it's the past or the future. But here it's more interesting that it's brought up on a new stage, this idea of time as the subjective time of developing space as a fragment put together through perception and not present.
Yeah, because it becomes architectural, it's slavery, it remains in our best.
Yes.
So it remains somehow on the level of painting.
Yeah.
Mm. Yes. Maybe in literature too. Mm.
I would like to ask you, could you please go back to the point of the Bauhaus building and the Picasso painting? Because I didn't get the point completely, so maybe you can repeat this part.
I will do it fast because I was concerned with the time. But actually, it's this first point that Gideon makes on the influence of Cubism on architecture, and he speaks about three phenomena. It's the transparency, the simultaneity, and the planarity. In his opinion, these three characteristics are common for the Cubist painting and the Bauhaus architecture. The planarity was understood as the pursuit of the Cubist to develop a form to present a whole body in his three dimensions in a plain form, so the simultaneous perspectives, and the transparency of this process of putting things together. But he seems to only take the notions, or I don't know if I'm too straight on to criticize Gideon like this, but this is how I understand it, that these notions are simplified, and the planarity of the Bauhaus per se is not the same with the planarity which is called upon through Cubist painting, and the transparency is also a different one. He makes also the point that this building gives us a simultaneous sensation of the space, because you can see from the inside to the from the outside to the inside and back, and so he seems to construct something. So that's was the point, that this was maybe the first hint or the first I know of, but a relatively constructive.
I think this is a bit, you know, this is about ideology. Diagonal somehow view through somehow the corner of this Wirtschaftsflügel. It's a construction. Mm-hmm. So you want to save Kokius. Well, then then Colin Rowe and Hursley, they do exactly the opposite.
Yes.
And they say, well, this is a dumb architecture, there's nothing to do with Cubism. Cubism is preserved for the French tradition,
yeah,
and not for the Bauhaus tradition. While Gideon is trying to help the Bauhaus.
Get cosmopolitan.
And it's today I read a nice article of Fritz Neumeier about Lies van der Rohe. It's very interesting that he argues a little bit similar. So in Haus Christus you have also this, you know, it's somehow the rooms are stepping forward.
Mm-hmm.
And also in the corner there are windows, and you can, from a certain point of view, you can look diagonally. And this is his big argument, you know,
mm-hmm,
for the space concept of Mies van der Rohe. This is a construction.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't hold when you are there. Maybe there's a moment when you can see this,
mm-hmm,
but it's probably not, brings not the building onto the how it's just a moment.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? And it's not what the building is about.
It's not the intention.
Yeah. Mm. But the discovery of the diagonal.
Yeah.
Just a stupid question. Which way does architecture change when these figures of the fragmentary are developed? So, what is it? Just say a manner of constructing that is typical for architectural approaches like the conceptualist one or Chabun's? Or does architecture fundamentally change once it has discovered a fragmentary way of practicing architecture? Because you know, early romanticists as Schlegel or Novalis had combined with fragmentary or fragment an entire program for history and for philosophy, etc. So it was immense what was attached to, according to their eyes or their approach to the fragment. So would you say the same for architecture that once, say in Chahun, when we now save with you his advance to a new thought of the fragmentary within architecture, does architectural practice fundamentally change, or is it just a personal whim of or something idiosyncratic from Chahun?
But I think it's a productive moment which points out the qualities of non-causal thought. That's what I was very interested yesterday when we were presenting this question of the I noted the notion, I forgot it, but I think the predisposition of space, so that a sense of the space is getting constructed through the mode of the way it's being used, like the spaces for producing thought, philosophy in the case, returns to the producer, to the philosophers, and then it goes back and influences architecture. And I think if I'm not constructing it very, very highly right now, that is the most productive moment about this concept of the fragmentary, which is not formal at all. It is that through involving the subject, it gives another perception of space for the user. And it also develops another concept of designing space. So it's not a monocausal effect. It's not fragmentary space makes better people, or better people make fragmentary space. But it's, Chahun speaks about his main intention when he speaks about his schools, for example, is that their function is to develop the consciousness of the children. So, Entwicklung der Bewusstseinsbildung, which is he doesn't offer the space as a container. They are not going inside and understand their school suddenly. They have to learn it. They have to learn to act upon it and find utility and so on. And that is one step. Then it can return to architecture as a new way of dealing with space and influence the way it's produced. So that's why I think it's helpful to leave this formal concept of fragmentary.
Well, I would like to get back to this concept of time as this agent for the fragmentary in architecture. Because I think it's quite essential to the topic and also in architecture. As we've seen here at the example of Franz Chahun, or maybe also Alvar Aalto, maybe in lesser degree, Alvar Aalto, yeah. But probably Franz Chahun. So if at a certain point this becomes the central finding and topic of your research, then you could start in the next step, maybe distinguish different types of time in architecture. Then maybe you find out that there is a special, that Peter Eisenmetz plays a special role among the deconstructivists. I just say that when the deconstructivist architects of the 1988 exhibition, they are falling back behind Hans Chahun. But for example, in the example I showed, the Guadalupe house, there's a time relation. Yeah. Each piece is somehow, how can I say that? It's there's a almost orchestrated through a process in time. and which is also a process of course then in space, it's seen in basic ecology.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be a different kind of concept of the fragmentary. Because it's, again, it's not just throwing a glass here or a bottle here on the floor and then assembling the
yeah.
fragments, just
yeah.
like Hadid did,
yeah.
and Kurt Himmelau and these guys. And then you find other concepts
mm-hmm.
Of time, which lead to a specific concept of fragmentary, which is not just assembling pieces.
yeah.
Yeah,
yeah,
which
yeah.
is not so interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And that could be maybe also interesting, you know, then differentiate the concept of time through the concept of the fragmentary.
By the way, I came across an Austrian architect, Eugen Groß, I think is his name, I met him in Vienna. He should be about late 70s now, but in the 60s he has made brutalist architecture
mm-hmm.
based on the concept of a time pattern. I found it very interesting
yeah.
he discussed the way he discussed
yeah.
it.
And also the example which Hannah showed, yes, which I criticized, but the Wotrupa church
yeah.
could be also an example
yeah.
maybe to study. Under the topic of time and fragmentary. There, again, you have another fragmentarization. So then this work could really develop into, you know, detach itself from this conventional concept of the fragmentary, which of course we all know,
mm-hmm.
And then start to develop a theory of the fragmentary in architecture. Period. yeah,
period.
Not only it's just that
yeah.
kind of stock historical narrative.
Yes, yes.
Maybe based on
yes,
on Schelling and Schelling and then romantics and then
okay.
jump into our times. Leave everything in between. That's a necessary historical
yeah.
somehow thing, and it's part of the dissertation.
Yes,
excuse me. Yes. Can you touch one more this kind of first phase of the construction, as you mentioned before, the time of Picasso started the work, or Cézanne, if you say better, about fragmentation in architecture now, because. Yes, this is fragmentation,
mm-hmm.
but there was also assemblage,
mm-hmm.
and the architects were going to kind of synthesis,
mm-hmm.
very strong synthesis in that time. I'm wondering why, what did you know architects well in this kind of movement of the construction, because the Koch-Kippenbau started in the 80s, even
something
else. Even 79,
mm-hmm.
70s, like the Vienna architect Hans Holland, who was making some other things, but inside for this very early approach of architecture as a deconstructivistic architect,
mm-hmm.
I'm not so sure. I would like to one sentence more about it.
That might be in case of Kurt Himmelau, it's a formal deconstruction. While Hans Scharoun is not. I think it's a conceptual deconstruction, if you want to use the word deconstruction. I think there's deconstructivism is at the beginning a very formal, for many of them, not all of them, but many of them, it's a formalism, a return to formalism. of course, with the of course, there's also a concept of time behind it, definitively, somehow breaking with the historical time of our postmodernism. Yeah, of course, there's also a time, but maybe a simple, rather simple concept of time. But if you are already discussing this, for example, also the postmodernist James Stirling. It's again a different discourse,
yes.
yeah?
Yes.
Because there's a concept of fragmentation, which is not a formal concept
yes.
of fragmentation. What you showed, you know, this hole where the stones broken, yeah, it's only just ironic piece, but it's not what James Stirling is about.
Mm.
But because he's also working with a synthesis somehow, but still, all pieces there have a kind of history, and they introduce a different kind of stories also.
Mm.
It's not the traditional, or it's not the, the usual postmodern concept of
yes, he has very similar moments, I think, with also with Angela and Charlotte. Think of the inventive factory. Mm. Or, yeah.
That was very interesting in this to compare ruins to future architecture.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the point. I think now I can understand better the start point of this lecture.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, why I started again with the ruins. I cannot help it every time.
But the concept is to look for the specific concept of ruin.
Yes, and I cannot get around it, so
I have to point
at
it, but thank you.
Any more questions or comments?
Do you think what is the role of the collapse of the modern meta-narratives in the consolidation of fragmentary as a sort of a new narrative for the whole postmodern condition? I mean, it's from a more meta-historical perspective. Is that part of your analysis? I mean,
yeah, the beginning of your question, the collapse of...
The collapse of the modern meta-narratives, which in
yeah,
a way
yeah.
kept the illusion of a sort of unity,
mm-hmm.
The unitary perspective of modern as a whole is collapsed, and then the fragment appears as a sort of new narrative for what we are living today.
Well,
in a way, it might, of course it's a sort of matter we all know about this.
Yeah.
The fragment is the index of the postmodern condition. It's its most, I would say, clear index.
What I find interesting is by starting at this point before the postmodernism is that on the one hand the fragmentary is being taken upon a different angle, like I tried to show, and also this critique or relative to the concept of the whole is already taking place. This is what these others are doing, the other moderns, and if you want their predisposition for the postmodern, but I think I'm not sure that it has to get so consecutive, so let's say that they are the predecessors of the postmodern, but they are definitely criticizing the totality of classical modern, and that is one of the central issues. The question is how they are doing it. Are they doing it through a formal language, or through this other possibilities of perceiving space through time and so on.